Hello, and this is on equilibrium thermodynamics. Equilibrium, as we already know, that thermodynamics gives an idea about how far the reaction will complete, will go, how far the reaction will proceed, whether to the far right or will remain far left. That is, we call it an impossible process, sometimes non-spontaneous process, and a highly possible process called spontaneous process or irreversible process. And in between, there is a reversible process where the reaction will proceed, no doubt, but it will come to a halt after the midpoint and adjust at the midpoint. Neither far to the right nor far to the left, it will remain at the midpoint, right? Now, we shall see quantitatively how the equilibrium constant, K equilibrium, equilibrium constant can be determined from the free energy change. Because the equilibrium constant will tell us exactly where the reaction will end. If it is more than 10 to the power 4 or 3 or 5, it is a huge number, several powers of 10, then we presume that the reaction is almost complete. More than 99% is complete. If it is less than 1, 10 to the minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, then the reaction is almost not happening. It is, we dare call it an impossible reaction or a non-spontaneous reaction. If the equilibrium constant will be exactly 1, then the reaction will proceed and it will come to the midpoint when equilibrium comes. Therefore, I thought of devoting an entire lecture on equilibrium thermodynamics. Often there is a confusion. Often. I will be trying to clarify this confusion, which is prevalent among students. Now, there is a thing which is called delta G0, that is fixed for a given reaction, that is fixed for a standard, at the standard state. This zero, superscript zero, is indicative of the standard state. If it is a chemical reaction or any physical process, then the temperature will be 25 degrees centigrade, room temperature, or 298 Kelvin. And if it's a gaseous component, it will be having 1 atmosphere. Now it is called 1 bar, little slightly different, as you know. And the molar concentration, if it is in the form of a solution in a solvent, then the molar concentration of the solution will be 1 molar. That is the standard state. So, if a reaction is 100% complete from 100% reactant to 100% product, what is the free energy change? Which is really not possible. Yes, 99.99% is possible, not 100%. In some cases, you know, it is not possible at all. Maybe 0.0001% possible. Even for that also, we can find delta G0. By indirect method, we will be knowing that those indirect methods in thermochemistry chapter. Later, when we complete thermodynamics. So, delta G0 is something which is a fixed quantity for a given reaction. Complete conversion, 100% conversion. But this delta G, which we will be discussing here, is a variable quantity. Start a reaction, delta G is highest. Negative, but highest. Is negative, if it is running, if reaction is happening, then delta G is numerically highest and it is negative. And as the reaction will proceed, time will elapse, the numerical value will decrease till it becomes equal to zero. actually there is a confusion here. It should not have been called delta G. This delta G automatically puts a confusion in the young minds that it can be free energy change of a reaction, whole reaction in non-standard condition. Yes, that can be. Delta G can refer to the change in free energy or Gibbs free energy for the entire 100% completed reaction for any non-standard condition. But here, what we shall discuss and what it is often discussed, delta G is a variable quantity, it is not a fixed quantity. Actually, it should have been called dG by dJ. It is a differential coefficient of free energy with respect to the progress of the reaction. Progress, time, progress of the reaction. In fact, that is the slope of the tangent drawn at any point in that graph, free energy versus time or composition graph. But customarily, we call this as delta G. It is dG by d, the slope of the tangent. I will show you the graph. But since we call it as delta G, just to have a better, you know, equation, good looking equation, there arises the confusion. Now, let me read out. For chemical reaction, delta G0 at a particular temperature is fixed, which is obtained by using the Gibbs-Helmholtz equation. Delta G0 is equal to delta H0 minus T delta S0. This is meant for complete reaction, which really never happens. It is calculated from standard free energy of formation of the species or the standard enthalpy of formation of the species, finding out the enthalpy change of the reaction and using Gibbs-Helmholtz equation, we can find out delta G0. I have not written here. We will be doing a problem on that. Of course, the working of those things will be done in our thermochemistry chapter. But I will explain you in a nutshell how to calculate the delta G0 values for a completed reaction, which is fixed at a given condition. But what we are looking, we will start the reaction now. Any, say, spontaneous reaction, we start. Then start measuring a variable quantity, that is delta G. But wrongly called delta G, actually this rate of change of free energy with progress of time or composition. Delta G, which is more correctly dG by dJ at constant temperature, however, is a changing parameter and finally becomes zero when the reaction attains equilibrium and no more further progress. In fact, it is the slope of the graph of G, free energy versus reaction coordinate, J, that is time. Indirectly, it is time. The reaction attains equilibrium when the slope of that curve vanishes, becomes zero. Now, see the graph. Now, this is the free energy of the pure reactant. R, supposing R is the reactant, P is the product. To simplify, I have taken one reactant, one product. So, it is 100% reactant and the absolute free energy is G0 of the reactant. I should have written R, reactant. And this is the absolute free energy of the product, 100% product. This one. I have wrongly put a, you know, here. It has to be, this is G0 of the product, this is 100% reactant, and the difference is delta G0, that we can measure indirectly by using thermochemistry principle. We can find out from the standard free energy of formation or standard enthalpy of formation. We will know how to calculate this delta G0 value, which is fixed. But what is variable during the course of reaction till equilibrium is this one. The graph starts like this. This delta G0. Once you look to the delta G0 value, you can have an idea whether the reaction will go far to the right or remain far to the left. it is a reactant favored process or a product favored process, or it will come to the midpoint like this. That idea you can have. But whether it is a reactant favored or product favored or mid favored, it will start from a negative delta G. This is delta G. And we have arbitrarily taken this as the base point, and the difference is delta G, which is variable. For simplicity, for students of your in class 11, we say delta G, which is variable. In the beginning of the reaction, it is the highest. And as time proceeds, as R, more and more R is converted to P, percentage of R decreases, percentage of P increases. So this value, the slope becomes lesser and lesser, still negative slope. So therefore, I have put a dot here and put a tangent, and I have written dg by dxi. That goes on numerically decreasing till it becomes zero here. It's zero. So for beginners, we call it delta g. That means from this final value where it attains equilibrium, and now where it is during the course of reaction, this is the variable delta g, which is numerically maximum at the start of the reaction, and it goes on decreasing till equilibrium reaches. From there, it cannot have a positive value. It halts. So as long as delta g 0 is negative, that means reaction is happening. Now find the difference. Now this delta g 0 is already calculated. It is already there for every reaction at a standard state. It is given, fixed for entire reaction. But we are starting a reaction from the beginning, the same reaction we are starting. And in the beginning, this delta G or dg by dxi was maximum numerically, negative. And the value, numerical value goes on decreasing. So we call to the students delta G, the variable delta G that goes on decreasing till it becomes zero. This is the base value. And this is zero. And it cannot increase. Zero means reaction stops, equilibrium comes. You know, if dg by dxi positive, that means you are here, slope is positive, then undoubtedly the backward reaction is happening. If you find some in a reaction, you find dg by dxi is positive, then definitely it is not the forward reaction happening, it is backward reaction happening. Because if you invert the graph, this will come to this side and this will go to this side, then the slopes will be negative, right? So once you are starting a reaction where you have got the signal delta G0 is negative, that means you are starting from the highest negative del G value, or more correctly dg by dxi value. Then how long it will continue? It will continue since this point is at a much lower level, this is a higher level, then it will be coming to equilibrium, the slope will be zero, very close to the product side. More is the difference, if delta zero will be still greater, that means this point will be remaining far top, it will be here or here somewhere much above, then this difference will be much greater. In that case, it will be the graph, the negative slope will persist till almost to the end of the reaction, so that the reaction will be nearly 99.99% complete, and then it will go up. That 0.01% will not happen because that is in the positive slope. So more is the delta G numerical value, greater is the extent of reaction, and it is more product favored reaction, right? And on the contrary, supposing a particular reaction you calculated that delta G0 is positive. That means the reactant has a lower absolute free energy. This is the G0 value of the reactant. This is the G0 value of the product. wrongly I've written delta G. So this is the product. And this is the difference, delta G. Product minus reactant. So this is positive. Unlike product minus reactant is negative, here product minus reactant is positive. So in that case, this will start from a negative slope, but suddenly it will come to equilibrium when the slope will vanish and it again it becomes positive slope. When it gets a positive slope, then the reaction, forward reaction is will not happen. You can't go to the positive slope. Supposing you find there is a positive slope, then that means the backward reaction is happening, not the forward reaction. That means if you invert this graph, this will come to this side, this will come to this side, it will be analogous to this, right? So if delta G0 is positive, you found from a reaction calculation, then predict that if you start such a reaction, it will halt after a bit. After a small movement, it will beat. Greater the positive value of delta G, more is the reactant favored. The reaction is, it will remain closer to the reactant side, almost no going ahead. Therefore, in such cases, if we call an impossible reaction or a non-spontaneous reaction, that will not happen. If it will happen to the extent of 0.001%, then it is better to say not happening. In principle, it will happen, however small it may be, but we don't feel like telling it is a process really happening, right? But if the two absolute values of free energy are same, reactant and product in the same level, and their difference is zero, delta G zero is zero, there is no difference like this or this. In that case, you know, your common sense says the graph, when you start the reaction, it will happen. Neither it will come closer to the product side when the equilibrium comes, when the slope becomes zero, nor it will remain closer to the reactant side like delta G is positive, but it will come to the midpoint and it will become zero. And then this is not possible because positive slope is not possible. Positive slope means that the reverse reaction is happening. You understand? So in this case, the equilibrium constant, as we shall discuss after a bit, is greater than 1. That means the equilibrium point is lying right to the midpoint. Supposing this is the midpoint, right to the midpoint, more right to the midpoint, that means closer to the product side, 100% product side, more is the delta G0 value. Negative, but more is the numerical value. Exactly opposite, more is the delta G0 value, positive delta G0 value, you know, closer the equilibrium point with respect to the starting point. That means the equilibrium point will remain to the left of the midpoint, supposing this is the midpoint. And greater this delta G, greater is the departure from the midpoint and closer to the 100% reactant side. And if it is exactly 1, equilibrium constant is 1, when delta G0 is 0. So the reaction will come to the midpoint and equilibrium constant is 1. So the great confusion is about delta G. Now let me come back to the actual Bantoff equation. Yes, this is the famous Bantoff equation. Delta G, which is wrongly coined for beginners, which should be dG by dz at constant temperature. That is the slope. But we call it delta G from reference from the equilibrium point to the variable point at where the reaction is now present. So that delta G goes on changing till it becomes zero. And this is the standard value which is fixed, delta G zero, for the 100% reaction plus RT ln Q. What is Q? Let me tell you. Q is called the reaction quotient. Reaction quotient. This Q goes on varying till equilibrium. Now, supposing reaction is AA plus BB gives rise to CC DD. Small letters are coefficients in the balanced equation, and the capital letters are the components, I mean reactants and products. Now, this Q is identical to the expression of equilibrium constant. We shall know about it in details in our equilibrium chapter, but just let me tell you that the molar concentrations of the products will remain in the numerator, and these coefficients will be appearing as power, and in the denominator you will get the molar concentrations of the reactants, and the corresponding coefficients will appear as powers, right? So that is Q, that is changing. Now as the reaction proceeds, the molarity of products is increasing, the numerator is increasing at the expense of denominator, which is decreasing. So the Q value is increasing. How long it will increase? Till equilibrium point. Equilibrium, once equilibrium reaches, there is no more change in CD and AB. So that becomes constant, and in place of Q, we write K, K equilibrium. So until equilibrium comes, Q is a variable quantity, just like delta Z is variable, and that varies along with Q. As the concentrations of the products and reactants are changing, delta G is also changing. The moment delta G becomes zero, this slope becomes zero, then this becomes constant. And then you cannot call it Q. You have to replace by a constant value called equilibrium constant. Got it? Now, the same thing I have shown in a copy paste mode. This I drew it, but it was faint. So I did it once again here, and I copy pasted from other source, from Google, where this K equilibrium constant is greater than 1, where the equilibrium point is lying to the right of the midpoint, where delta Z is negative, and it will, you know, it will the slope will be decreasing numerically and becomes 0, and then you will have positive slope. This reaction cannot proceed once this point is reached. But when delta is positive, that means delta G0 is positive, then definitely the midpoint, equilibrium point will remain to the left of the midpoint. More the difference and more the delta G0 value, you know, this point will be coming closer to the reactant side. Same is the case here. More the delta G0 value, negative will be there. Closer will be this equilibrium point to the product side. And if it is exactly zero, then the midpoint, it will come to the equilibrium at the midpoint. So we again go to the same thing. This is the famous Van't Hoff equation. There's a variable delta G, which is really dz by dz is a variable thing, is equal to del G0 plus RT ln Q. Q is the reaction quotient, which varies from time to time till equilibrium. Therefore, in our Gibbs-Helmholtz equation, we studied when del 0 is negative, the reaction is spontaneous. You can get an idea that reaction is product favored, spontaneous, or right favored. You can get an idea. But when you start the reaction, it will start from a negative delta G value, and it will start to decrease numerically till it becomes zero. Once it becomes zero, this Q will be replaced by K, K equilibrium. You understand? So, but we have been a habit of saying when delta G zero is greater than less than zero, the reaction is spontaneous, as if it is happening. You get an idea, it will be spontaneous. When delta G zero is greater than zero, it is non-spontaneous. If at all it will happen, it will remain closer to the reactant side. And most importantly, what mistake we commit when delta G0 is 0, the reaction is at equilibrium. What does it mean, the reaction is at equilibrium? It means nothing. When delta G0 is 0, the equilibrium constant will be 1. That means it will come to equilibrium at the midpoint, as if in all the other two cases there will be no equilibrium. In all the three classes there will be equilibrium, but when delta G0 is 0, then the process will happen and it will come to equilibrium at the midpoint, when K equilibrium constant will be 1. So you must understand very conceptually. So when this becomes 0, then Q term will be replaced by K equilibrium. This is called equilibrium constant. This molar concentrations will be fixed. There will be no more change after that. Then that is called K equilibrium. So let us put 0 here and replace Q by K equilibrium. By doing so, we have got, you put 0 and this KC and bring delta G0 to one side, then it will become delta G0 is equal to minus, converting ln to log, it will be minus 2.303 RT log K equilibrium. Delta G0, that is the standard value which is for the complete reaction. There is no more variable. Variable has become 0. So, while looking to the delta G0 value, if it is negative, then definitely negative will become positive. So, equilibrium constant will be greater than 1. Greater the equilibrium constant, farther it will be remaining towards the right, farther from the midpoint, and it will be a product favored process. And if delta G0 is positive, this is positive, then K equilibrium, log K is negative, then K equilibrium will be less than 1. 0.1 or 0.01 or 0.0001, 10 to the power minus 4. So it will be less than 1. The lesser the value than 1, less is the possibility of the reaction. It will be more and more reactant favored, more and more impossible reaction. And if delta G0 is equal to 0, then the reaction will happen and it will attain equilibrium when K equilibrium is equal to 1. Or the equilibrium constant will be equal to 1. Right? Now, let us stretch a little bit more. Delta G0 is equal to minus RT ln K. Put it again in the ln form. And in place of delta G0, let us use the Gibbs-Helmholtz equation. Del H0 minus T del S0. Then, keep ln K on one side and keep the rest on the other side. So, this term becomes positive. So, del S0 by RT, T get cancelled. Minus del H0 by RT. Whole RT comes to the other side. So, keep ln K means K equilibrium constant on left, and take others to the right. So, you get the same Van 't Hoff equation in log form or in ln form. And if you draw a graph of ln K as y coordinate and 1 by T, here you see T is in the denominator. So, take 1 by T as the x coordinate. You will find the plot will be a straight line having negative slope, because this is negative. This is negative. And the intercept will give you del S0 by R. You can find del S0 value from that. That is entropy change, standard entropy change from that, from the intercept. And the slope will give you the del H0 by R. Slope is minus del S0 by R, provided, this is delta H is positive. If delta H is positive, then it is an endothermic process. Then the graph will be like this. It will be having negative slope because there is a minus sign here. So, del H has to be positive in order to have a negative slope. But if it is an exothermic reaction, del H is negative, then negative becomes positive, then the nature of the graph will be different. It will be like this. It will be a straight line with a positive. This is minus and this. Again, if it is minus exothermic, then minus minus plus, so the graph will be having positive slope. But intercept will be as usual del S0 by R, and the numerical value of slope, then it was negative slope, it was now positive slope, will be del S0 by R. Same, but the nature of the graph will change. Now, if you take the difference between two conditions, supposing one equilibrium constant is at temperature T1, so ln K1 is equal to del S0 by R minus del S0 by RT1, and similarly it is the equilibrium constant is K2 at temperature T2, similar equation, presuming that entropy change and enthalpy change remains constant at the two temperatures. And you know, when the temperature range is limited, narrow, then the change in entropy and enthalpy will be remain same. If it is a large variation in temperature, then both entropy change will vary and as well as enthalpy change will vary. That we will see later. But here we have presumed del S0 and del S0 are same both in temperature T1 and T2. So let us subtract ln K2 minus ln K1. This term, del S0 term, will cancel and since this will be positive k2, sorry, this will be positive because ln k2 minus ln k1, so this term will be positive, then taking common, ln k2 minus ln k1 is equal to ln k2 by k1 is equal to del h0 by r common, then 1 by t1 minus 1 by t2. So this is another famous Van't Hoff's equation in where to compare between two equilibrium constant values at two different temperatures. So from here we can conclude that if del h0 is negative, it is an exothermic process. If this is negative and T1 is always a lower temperature, T2 at a higher temperature, you will find K2 will be less than K1. You will find mathematically. Physical interpretation will be learning and in Lee Chatelier's principle in our equilibrium chapter. But mathematically, when delta H0 is negative, it is an exothermic process. Equilibrium constant K2 is less than K1 means equilibrium constant decreases with increase in temperature. But if it is endothermic process, it is positive, then K2 will be greater than K1 as temperature increases. So equilibrium constant increases with increase in temperature for endo, and equilibrium constant decreases with increase in temperature if it is exothermic, negative. Positive, it increases with increase in temperature. I think we close with a numerical, and I will tell you how to find out the standard and from the standard enthalpy change of formation, how to find the enthalpy change of the reaction. In a similar manner, you can find the standard free energy change of a reaction from the standard free energy of formation of each individual species. Now, read this problem. For the reaction nitrogen plus hydrogen giving ammonia, this should have been a reversible sign. I replace now with a reversible sign. The standard enthalpy of formation. Enthalpy of formation of standard enthalpy of formation and molar entropies are given below in the table. Predict whether the reaction will be spontaneous at 25 degree centigrade or not. And also calculate the equilibrium constant Kp. I'll tell you what is that. Now, we will know later in our thermochemistry program that the enthalpy change that happens during the formation of one mole of a particular compound from its constituent elements in their standard state is called enthalpy of formation. Enthalpy of formation. And for elements, since enthalpy of formation is found out for compounds, the enthalpy of formation of any element is zero. So because we are getting compound from element, so only when you are getting compound has either positive or negative enthalpy of formation, but elements have zero enthalpy of formation. It is already there. You are not forming an element in the standard state like O2, N2. They are in the standard state as diatomic, right? So the standard enthalpy of formation of elements are zero kilojoules per mole, and for ammonia the standard enthalpy of formation has been found out minus 46.11. I will tell you this. To get one mole of ammonia from nitrogen and hydrogen, how much of energy is changed? This is the molar 1.32. But for one mole of ammonia formation, this will be half, this will be 3 by 2, and this will be 1. So for one mole, what will be the total energy change for getting one mole of ammonia? Total, 100% complete. Completion. That you can find out. We will learn about that in thermochemistry. Nothing to worry. So this is minus 46.11 for ammonia formation. And for elements it is zero. And the absolute entropies of nitrogen is this much of hydrogen per mole basis. But we have to multiply by 3. Because entropy is an extensive property, but it is given as intrinsic property. So per mole is given, and ammonia, the entropy, absolute entropy is 192.45 joules per Kelvin per mole. Mind you, the absolute entropies can be determined. They can be determined by using third law of thermodynamics, which we shall have a program on that, the video program on third law later. So to find out let me take up this nitrogen plus 2 hydrogen giving you 2 ammonia. So what is the standard enthalpy of the reaction, entire reaction, if whole reaction will complete? You will calculate. That is a formula. I am just telling you the formula. That is the sum total of the enthalpy of formation of all the products, enthalpy of formation, of course standard, of all the products, minus the sum total of enthalpies of formation of all the reactants. This is the standard formula that we use to find out the energy change in any reaction is equal to all the species of right hand side, that means product, the entire heat of formation or enthalpy of formation of the products, minus the entire heat of formation of the reactants. That will give you the heat change that happened during the complete reaction that you are writing. So let us find out that. So for this reaction, the right hand side there are 2 moles, and for 1 mole the enthalpy of formation is minus 46.11. So this is let me find out in terms of joules. This is in kilojoules. So this is minus 46110 in joules. Joules for Kelvin per mole, but we multiply by 2. There are 2 moles here, right? I am not writing per Kelvin per mole. And there is no more product. Minus, there is 1 mole nitrogen, 0. For element, the standard enthalpy of formation is 0. And there are 2 moles, doesn't matter. For elemental species, the enthalpy of formation is 0, right? So therefore, this term vanishes. So the enthalpy of this reaction, the whole reaction, is if we multiply, it will be minus 92.220. This much joules. So immediately we can find out delta G0. Once we know the standard enthalpy of formation, standard enthalpy of the reaction, the whole reaction, this reaction, from the formula that I gave you, then we find out what is the standard free energy change for the reaction, for the whole reaction, to make a prediction, is equal to del H0 minus, I'm so sorry, I'm yet to find out the entropy change of the reaction. Let me find out entropy change. Same entropy of RHS species, right side species, products, minus entropy of all the reactants, LHS species. So let us find out 2 moles of ammonia per 1 mole. What is the entropy? Absolute entropy is 192.45. Minus, there are 2 reactants. So 1 mole of nitrogen into nitrogen, the entropy, standard enthalpy of formation is 0, but entropy, it has got entropy at standard state. So 191.61. Plus, there are 2 moles, I am so sorry, 3 moles. Here it is 3 moles, I am so sorry. 3, and therefore, although it is 0, but I made a mistake, 3 moles of hydrogen, right? So here also, 3 moles of hydrogen means the absolute entropy of hydrogen is 130.68. So the net answer I have already calculated is minus 198.75 joules per Kelvin. Here is not per mole. This is the entire reaction. Joules per Kelvin per reaction, right? Whatever representation you had. Now, obviously, when you look to the reaction, it appears the entropy is decreasing. There are 4 moles, gaseous moles here, and there is only 2 moles. So, there is a decrease in entropy, but what amount? 198.75. Okay, we calculated del H0 and del S0. Then, let us use the Gibbs-Helmholtz equation to find out delta G0, standard free energy of formation, del H0 minus T del S0. So this is already done, minus 92.220 minus T into del S is minus 198.75. So T is 25 means 298. So if you calculate, this becomes minus minus plus. So the net answer is coming 32,992.5 joules. So since delta G0 is negative, and highly negative, it is a hugely possible and spontaneous reaction. The process is spontaneous. And you know equilibrium constant will lie far to the right. It is a far product favored reaction. Let us find out. What is the equilibrium constant quantitatively. So we know the equation. What is that? From the Van't Hoff equation, del G0 is equal to minus RT ln. So if you convert ln to log, it is 2.303 RT log K equilibrium. And if all are gases, then that equilibrium constant is called equilibrium constant with respect to partial pressure. You will know about that later in our equilibrium program. So let me write Kp. If all are gases, then by default, the equilibrium constant is with respect to partial pressure, right? So we can find out minus 32, because delta G0 is minus 32992.5 is equal to minus 2.303 into R is 8.3, temperature is once again 298 into log Kp. So minus minus becomes plus, then I found log Kp is equal to 5.791. So if you take anti-log, so Kp, I'm sorry, it should be capital K. So the equilibrium constant with respect to partial pressure is coming 6.18 into 10 to the power 5. So use. So if the equilibrium constant is coming in the order of 10 to the power 5, it is almost a product favored reaction. The percentage of product will be more than 99%. So we can dare say it is a spontaneous reaction, favored reaction, and product favored reaction, highly possible reaction, but alas, I told you when thermodynamics say yes, it has said yes now. It means it may be. But had it been 10 to the minus 5, it is reactant favored, so it will remain close to the left. So we say if thermodynamics say no, it means no. It will not happen. The happening is almost insignificant. But thermodynamics is in this case saying yes, it is a very, very favorable process. Go ahead, get ammonia. But kinetics will come as a villain. The rate of reaction is so slow at 25 degrees centigrade that it will take years to get almost 99.9, above 99% of the product. Years almost doesn't happen at room temperature. So slow. Therefore, there is no point in becoming happy that yes, it is a possible, it is a very, very favorable process. There is no point in becoming happy because the kinetics is so, the activation energy is so large that it cannot make the reaction really happen in any detectable speed. So the equilibrium will come literally thousands of years later. Therefore, we have to manipulate, raise the temperature. Even if the yield, even if the equilibrium constant becomes less, we will be content with a lower yield of the product, where the equilibrium constant remains at the middle or maybe to the left. Some amount of ammonia will be happy, but let it happen. And during our lifetime, in a measurable time, we can get. I'm just kidding to say lifetime, but within a finite time, which is economically viable, we can get ammonia even if the yield is not very favorable. So that technique is used in optimizing temperature in the Haber's process. We will be knowing that in our equilibrium chapter. I think we close this session. And let me tell you how far it has proceeded. 44 minutes, this equilibrium thermodynamics, but I think you have enjoyed it. Next time we'll enter into further discussion on second law. I will try to plan out. Second law is not yet complete, and we will be entropy change is over, and we will be going to Carnot cycle. Yeah, the important one is Carnot cycle. Bye bye.